Hachette Books Ireland presents The Reunion by Roisin Meaney, read by Shelley Atkinson. September 2015. Leaving Cert Class of 1995. The principal and staff of St. Finian's Secondary School are delighted to invite you to a 20-year reunion on Saturday, October 10 at 7:30 p.m. in the Abbey Lodge Hotel for drinks and finger food. RSVP by September 26. Eleanor.
I need a tenner.
She turns from the sink and regards his glum face across the room. When did she last see him smile?
A tenner,
he repeats, a hair's breadth more slowly, for the benefit of his retarded mother. She doesn't miss it. What for?
A book for school.
A book? I thought we got them all. A millisecond of silence, filled with his impatience, overflowing with it.
It's notes for history.
Notes? Were they not on the list? He shoves back his chair abruptly. It screeches across the tiles, making her start.
Forget it, he says, and something else under his breath, that she doesn't hear.
He's gone before she can respond, letting the door swing not quite closed after him. She hears him galloping up the stairs like he always does, taking 3-4 steps at a time in giant bounds, with the long legs he didn't inherit from either of his parents. He'll wake Gordon, who never gets to bed before 1. Of course she'll give him the money. It might be for notes, like he says, and she doesn't want to get on the wrong side of his new school this early on. Or it might be for something else entirely, like the cigarettes he thinks she doesn't smell on him, or the alcohol he may well be sampling by now. She had her first swig of cider when she wasn't much older than 14. She can still remember the excitement, the tart forbidden burn of it. She'd be surprised if he wasn't up to something similar by now. Hopefully he's not into anything worse. She knows so little about him. Such a gulf there is between them. She wipes her hands on her apron and tries to squeeze the dripping hot tap shut again. A washer, she knows that's all it needs, but she's afraid to chance doing it herself. Gordon keeps promising to get it sorted, but she's still waiting. She'll ask Mike, 2 doors down, next time she sees him. Retired plumber, could do it with his eyes closed. Gordon won't even notice. She takes her purse from her bag and finds 2 fivers. She folds them and places them carefully on the edge of the white plate that holds the remains of Jacob's breakfast, the smear of egg yolk, the curves of toast crust. As she waits for him, she picks at crumbs on the tablecloth, which is white like the crockery and crisp with starch. She likes a nicely dressed table, a legacy from her days of working in Fennelly's, and washing and ironing the cloths gives her something to do. She dabs butter onto Jacob's crusts and eats them 1 by 1, standing at the sink. She sips lukewarm coffee and watches the second hand of the wall clock float around silently. The radio presenter is indulging in painfully humorless banter with the AA Roadwatch girl. He plays decent music. If only she could tune out the blather in between. The upstairs toilet flushes. The bathroom door is flung open immediately afterwards. No hands washed, she'll bet. She hears him crashing about in his room, yanking out drawers, slamming them shut. Ironic that someone so frugal with his words, so silent in her presence, can be so noisy in other ways. Then again, he always has plenty to say to his father. She brings his dishes to the sink, scrubs the egg residue from his plate. She enjoys washing up, likes the feel of the hot sudsy water, the shiny crockery that emerges from it. She rubs a finger across the wet plate just to hear it squeak. She pulls out the plug and watches the water swirl away. "Come and get it," she calls when she hears him flying down the stairs, damned if she's going to bring it out to him. He reappears and stands on the threshold, rucksack slung across a shoulder, hip jutting out beneath, looking but not looking at her. The 14-year-old mystery she and Gordon created. "There's your money," she says, and he crosses to the table and claims it.
Thanks. He shoves it into his trouser pocket.
How's school? She asks. How are you liking it?
Fine. He leaves the room. She listens to the click of the front door closing.
Goodbye, she says, to nobody at all. Have a lovely day.
He'll leave this house for good, as soon as he can. Probably as abruptly as that. He'll never visit again unless he needs something from her. He and Gordon will still see one another, but it'll be somewhere else, somewhere she's not. Or he and Gordon might leave together. The thought slices into her like a blade. She elbows it away. She dries the dishes and stores them in neat bundles in the press. She leans against the sink and finishes her coffee, cold by now, as a washed-out sunbeam lights up the dust motes in the air, and Hosier sings about rhythm and blues, and Clarence paces on the outside sill, mewing crossly. Poor old Clarence. She forgot about him again. The reunion invitation sits where she dropped it on the worktop. She scans the few lines for the second time. Can it really be 20 years? Who is principal of the school now? She has no idea. Sister Carmody died, didn't she? A good while back, she thinks. Dad, it must have been, who told her. He always kept an eye on the death columns, still does. As a schoolgirl, Eleanor came to know Sister Carmody's office well. Usually she was summoned after a teacher complained, homework not done, cheek given. But one time, towards the end of her junior cert year, it was because she'd been spotted coming out of a pub with Andrew and a few others. Some busybody with nothing better to do, ringing the school to report her. Your parents would be so disappointed, Sister Carmody had said. Like getting a bit sloshed at 16 was the worst thing you could do. Poor woman didn't know the half of it. St. Finian's is co-ed now. She knows that much from Mum. Joined forces with the Christian Brothers down the road 8 or 9 years ago. Did away with the uniforms too. No more tartan tunics to be seen on the streets when she goes back home to visit. Probably no nuns left on the staff now either, or brothers. Vocation's a thing of the past. People reluctant to ally themselves with a toxic institution. 20 years since leaving CERT, though. Hard to believe. She turned 18 that year, 3 months after Caroline's 19th birthday in May. Chalk and cheese, the two of them. Caroline, the quiet, sensible older one, her nose always stuck in a book. No wonder the nuns couldn't believe she and Eleanor were sisters. But despite their differences, or maybe because of them, they never had a falling out, or nothing serious, all through childhood and puberty and adolescence. They weren't close, not in the way you'd expect two sisters so near in age to be, particularly when they had no other siblings, but they weren't enemies either. Ironic that it was Caroline, not Eleanor, who ended up in trouble when she was just 17. Packed off to England by Mum before she could disgrace them all. And Eleanor, to her surprise, found that she missed her elder sister. Nothing was ever the same after that. Caroline was changed when she came home to them, no denying it. Still quiet, still the perfect student. But there was something different about her. Never really settled again, never really fitted in the way she used to, at home or in school. And the minute she could, she went back to England, couldn't wait to get back. She and Eleanor have kept in touch, of course. They talk on the phone roughly once a week. Granted, their conversations aren't exactly deep and meaningful. They're more like the chit-chat you'd put on someone beside you in the doctor's waiting room. But the main thing is they're keeping track of one another, not letting their lives drift apart. 20 years. Eleanor still can't get her head around it. All the plans she had growing up, her future mapped out at 16. Nothing turned out like she'd expected it to. Nothing went the way she'd thought it would after she left school. It started off okay, though. When she married Gordon Fenley, she was just 20 and mad about him. She was 5'4" in her stockinged feet and weighed 8.5 stone, give or take a pound or two. Her stomach was flat and firm, her thighs lean, her curves where she wanted them. Those days she lived in tight size 8 jeans and skimpy t-shirts, or sweaters that molded to her shape, clothes designed to show off her figure. Same weight no matter what she ate, no matter how little exercise she took. She was lucky, everyone said so. And then came 2 pregnancies in rapid succession, and her weight went shooting off the Richter scale, of course it did. She was happy and in love and well able to cook, and she had a husband who was very good at feeding her, and who didn't give a damn what the scales said when she stepped up on them. But by the time her second child was born, she weighed over 12 stone, and she decided, happy as she was, that enough was enough, and she set out to lose the extra blubber. And she did, pretty much. By the beginning of July 2002, 10 months after giving birth to baby number 2, she weighed just under 9 stone. And if her stomach wasn't anything like as flat as it used to be, and her thighs had a bit more wobble to them than before, she didn't much care. She was a mother of 2, she was entitled to a few wobbles. And then, on the 5th of July that year, a few weeks before her 25th birthday, Eleanor Plunkett Fennelly's world collapsed around her, and she stopped caring about her weight or anything else, and all the fat came tumbling back, and more with it. Imagine showing her face at the reunion, looking the way she does now. Imagine the glances of pity and disbelief, the turning heads when she'd appear, bringing her high blood pressure and cholesterol and increased risk of heart disease and stroke along with her. Imagine the stares she'd get, all decked out in a tent dress and nice shoes. She can still wear nice shoes, her feet the only part of her that hasn't gone completely to pot. She just can't stand in them for any length of time. The principal and staff are delighted to invite you. She opens the back door, and Clarence hops down and sidles in, giving his guttural mew as he pours himself around her ankles, threading in and out as she attempts to cross the room. One of these days he's going to trip her up. She'll fall and break a hip, and he'll walk over her on the way to his food. But for some reason she's fond of him, the old scrounger. He doesn't pretend to give a tinker's curse about anyone but himself, as he pads single-mindedly through his 9 lives. Clarence was never planned. He simply appeared. He invited himself into the kitchen one morning when Eleanor was in the garden hanging clothes on the line. When she came back, there he was, sitting just inside the door, washing his face, ignoring her until she found some cold meat in the fridge and set it on the floor beside him. That was 6 years ago, and he still turns up twice or 3 times each day. Jacob used to watch out for him. He was the one who gave him the name. But around the time he entered his teens, his interest in the cat trailed away, and now he pays him scant attention if their paths intersect. He'd like a dog, according to Gordon. But Eleanor can't face the prospect of another creature around the place. She can just about handle Clarence. She shakes pellets into the cracked saucer that serves as his bowl. By the way he attacks them, diving in, shoving her hand out of the way with his big head, you'd swear he hadn't eaten in a week. A mouse-sized portion, the vet says, more than enough. But Clarence snuffles his way through twice that and looks for seconds. Having him around means Eleanor isn't the only fatty in the house. Maybe that's why she likes him. She sticks the invitation to the door of the fridge with a magnet that says, "I love to cook with wine. Sometimes I even put it in the food." A joke present from Caroline, when Eleanor and Gordon opened Fennelly's the year they got married, attached to the fridge door for the past 17 years. When they'd been awarded the Michelin star in May 2002, Caroline had got them a crystal decanter from Avoca. Another magnet would hardly have done Michelin justice. 10th of October the reunion is, less than 6 weeks away. Just for the hell of it, she circles the date with a highlighter pen, on the calendar that hangs by the door. Of course she's not going, no way is she going. She lets the September page drop back into place, and the 12th stares out at her, 5 days from now. She'll get through it. She always does. She turns her thoughts back to Jacob, beginning his 2nd week in the school. Must be tough being the new boy in junior search year, joining a group who'd already spent 2 years together. Boys that age not the most welcoming, maybe. A few months before the summer, Gordon said they'd have to take him out of boarding school. The fees are crippling. We need to economize. It was unexpected. She knew the restaurant was going through a lean time, but was it really necessary to move Jacob? He'd been boarding at a school 50 miles away for 2 years, coming home on the bus at weekends. He'd seemed happy enough there. And privately, Eleanor found it easier without him around all the time. But now he was to be uprooted just before his junior cert. Still, what could she do, with Gordon saying they couldn't afford the fees? It might be for the best, she told herself, if they had to live together full time. It might help to fix what was broken between them. So far, it hasn't made a difference. He comes home in the afternoon, he makes a sandwich, he vanishes. Up to his room, or out with the few friends he's kept in touch with since primary school. He reappears for dinner at 7, which he eats with Eleanor in near silence. Impossible to have a conversation with him. Whatever she tries gets her nowhere. And takes his leave of her again as soon as he can. The new school is a bit of a trek. It's on the far side of Galway, because Gordon was dead set against the Christian Brothers down the road. You'd understand, he told Eleanor, if you'd gone there. So each morning, Jacob gets a bus. And each afternoon the bus brings him home again, and so far he hasn't complained. Or not to her. When she asks, everything is fine. But Gordon hasn't mentioned anything either, so hopefully the move is working out. The morning passes like it always does. Gordon puts in an appearance around 10. He makes coffee and toasts sourdough while Eleanor loads the washing machine in the utility room and takes the ashes from the sitting room fireplace and empties the various waste paper baskets and checks the fridge to see what they're out of. He reads the paper as rapidly as he eats. He's gone by 10:30, calling goodbye from the hall. She can't remember the last time he kissed her goodbye, or kissed her at all. Around an hour later, as she plugs in the kettle for more coffee, her phone rings. She follows the sound and sees it sitting by the bread bin. She reads her husband's name on the screen. I need a clean shirt, he says. My pen leaked on this one. I'll drop it in, she replies, lifting the bread bin lid to peer inside. No need, I'll send Keith. He'll be there in 20 minutes. He doesn't want her in the restaurant. She bats away the thought before it can take root. I got an invitation, she says quickly, not giving him time to hang up. My school, a 20-year reunion. As she speaks, she pulls a piece of crust from the remains of the sourdough. Right. His absent tone means he's doing something else, checking the lunch menu or seeing what the bookings look like for this evening. I won't go, she says. They'd laugh if they saw me now. Whatever you think, he says. Look, I'd better get moving. She hears the tiny click of his disconnect. She can't blame him. She pushed him away, pushed them both away, and now they're out of her reach. There's nothing left of what she and Gordon had. Nothing except Jacob to hold them together, for however long he does. She spreads butter on the crust and chews it silently as Paloma Faith sings on the radio. Eleanor saw her in some music video not so long ago. All blonde hair and red lipstick. Perfect, dainty little figure. She brushes crumbs from her hands. She unties her apron and drapes it over the back of a chair. As she heads upstairs to find a clean shirt and to put on a bit of lipstick for Keith, she thinks about giving her sister a ring. Or she might wait until tomorrow. Caroline. The last time she was in the Abbey Lodge Hotel was in May 2000. She was a week past 24, wearing a fake tan and a green dress she'd made herself. Sparkly clips in her hair, a smudge of gold on her eyelids. You're looking well, he'd said, fortified no doubt by a few Harvey Wallbangers or whatever concoction he'd gone for at the cocktail bar. Lying in wait for her near the women's loo, his wife Sophie safely out of earshot. Caroline could see her near the buffet table in conversation with Eleanor, who had yet to tell anyone that she was pregnant with Jacob, and widowed Mrs. Lee, second next door to the Plunketts, whose only son Douglas, Dougie, would be dead in 16 months. Tragic Mrs. Lee, who'd boast to everyone she met about Dougie and the fine job he'd landed himself in New York, who'd show them the postcard he'd sent of the monstrously tall silver towers where his office was located. "The 94th floor," she'd say, pointing to the red oval he'd drawn around a row of tiny windows. "Imagine being up that high every day." Pitiable Mrs. Lee, who taught Caroline the piano, or tried to, years before. Eleanor, of course, had flatly refused any kind of music lessons. "So how are you?" he'd asked, looking good still at 54, in his white shirt and black suit and red dicky bow, his drink cradled in the manicured hand that 7 years earlier had found its way inside her underwear. He'd pulled £20 from his wallet 15 minutes later with the same hand, thanking her for babysitting Nadine, telling her that Sophie would be in touch when they got back from France. Cool as a cucumber, as if he hadn't taken a detour when he was driving her back to her parents' house. As if he hadn't done what he'd done when he'd parked the car. "So how are you?" he'd had the gall to ask, after turning his back on her when she'd gone to him 6 weeks later in tears, after his denials and his insinuations and his snarled threats, throwing money at her as if it could fix what he'd broken. "None of your business," she'd replied, whisking her dress out of the way as she steered around him, continuing on her way to the ladies' toilet, while her mother tapped a fork against a glass so that everyone would shut up and listen to the speech she'd written for her husband to recite. Their silver wedding anniversary, 25 years of her telling him what to do. 25 years of golf outings and tennis tournaments and 2 foreign holidays a year, and never, ever a hint of a scandal. A quarter of a century of happy family life, if you didn't count the time that poor Caroline had her breakdown and had to spend the best part of a year away from them. Only, of course, that wasn't what had happened at all. What had happened was Jasper Darcy and everything that had followed him. But things are better now, most of them. Truth be told, they're better than better now. Most of them. She drops the invitation onto the dressing table and sprays floral, talcum powdery scent from Italy on her wrists and behind her ears. The aroma brings Matteo to mind, as it always does. "Put some here," he would whisper, "and the here." Wicked man. Today is Tuesday. In 3 days she'll see him. She smiles into the mirror as she sets down the perfume bottle. 4 more days and she'll be spraying perfume in different places. She scans the invitation again. Finger food, it says. That'll be cubes of rubbery cheese impaled between grapes on wooden sticks. That'll be wings of chickens, more bone than flesh. That'll be baby tomatoes with their insides replaced, and halves of hard-boiled eggs cowering under yellowing mayonnaise. Finger food. They couldn't even stump up for a proper dinner. She won't go, of course, no question. She drops the invitation into the tin bucket that serves as her bin. She painted it red, stuck some flower transfers onto it. "You missed your calling," Florence had said when she saw it. "You should have been a hippie." Her phone rings. Her sister's name on the screen evokes the same mix of guilt and impatience that it has done for years. "Hi there," she says, hearing the horrible jollity that her voice always assumes for Eleanor. "Did you get an invite to the reunion?"
"I did, this morning."
"Mine came yesterday. Are you going?"
"Probably not."
"Definitely not. Absolutely not."
"Me neither. Wild horses wouldn't drag me."
No surprises there. Eleanor doesn't do socializing anymore, unless Gordon asks her along to some Fenley's thing. But as far as Caroline knows, that hasn't happened in quite a while. Eleanor doesn't do fun anymore. But Caroline must be kind, with Beth's 14th birthday coming up in 4 days.
How are things? She asks. How are you feeling, Elle?
I'm all right.
Pause.
You know yourself. But Caroline doesn't know, because her child didn't fall into a swimming pool before he was one. As far as she knows, her child is still alive, still out there somewhere. 21 since March, a man now. And the hope still fervent in her that one day he'll come looking for her.
Why don't you come for a visit? She asks, like she has so often asked. You could stay for a night or two. I'm not going to Italy till Friday evening. We'd love to have you.
Hating herself briefly for the lie, Florence would not love to have her. But it's a safe lie, because Eleanor never takes up the invitation.
Not just now. Maybe another time. Thanks.
Same answer as always, and neither of them ever pins down another time. Caroline lets the silence drift, turning her head to look through the tiny square of bedroom window. Putty grey sky again today. No Indian summer for them yet. No consolation for a dismal July and an only marginally better August. Thank God for Italy, with its mile-high blue skies and sun that shines when it's supposed to. September in Italy is magical. She thinks of Matteo again and smiles again.
How's Jacob? She asks. How's the new school?
Her sister's sigh rushes into her ear.
Oh, he's all right, I think. He tells me nothing. It's his age, Caroline says, when both of them know his age has nothing to do with it.
He asked for a tenner yesterday, for books, he says, but we paid his book list before the summer.
They must have forgotten one.
She feels sorry for Jacob, the child who didn't drown, whose mother pretty much abandoned him when Beth died. Poor Jacob, caught in the middle of that tragedy, too young to understand what had happened, but suffering the fallout ever since.
Tell him his godmother says hello anyway. And how's Gordon?
Oh, he's the same. Her voice fading a little, as if she's turned her head to avoid the question. 20 when she married him, Gordon more than double that at 42. He's aging well, though, despite the sad, lost life he and Eleanor have had together. His face is nicely shabby, his melancholy smile endearing.
Hanging in there,
he'd said, the last time Caroline asked how Fenley's was doing. But they'd lost their precious Michelin star last year, and Eleanor told her a month or so ago about another restaurant opening not too far from theirs. The recession finally being spoken about in the past tense. People daring to start new businesses again. But Fenley's had weathered the bad times, had come through the recession when others were collapsing around it. Surely it will survive now. Surely Gordon will pull it out of its slump. She remembers how hungry he was at the start, how driven to succeed he and Eleanor both were, working all hours to get the recognition Fenley's eventually achieved. She remembers well the day they got married. Valentine's Day, 1998. Eleanor looking radiant, happier than Caroline ever remembered. Twirling before her bedroom mirror in the ivory silk dress that had cost a bomb. How do I look? She'd asked, and Caroline told her beautiful, and it was true. Crazy about Gordon then, despite the age difference. You only had to look at her to know. Crazy about him still, maybe. But the evidence, any time Caroline meets them, is lacking. He's only 59 now, not old these days. Funny how the gap between them seems to narrow as the years go on, as if Eleanor is catching up with him. If she'd only lose some of the weight, find a therapist, take some pride in her appearance. She cuts off the thought. No point. I suggested a counselor, Gordon had said, a few months after Beth's death. She was having none of it. Caroline has hinted at it too, more than once, but Eleanor brushes it aside. She can't or won't talk to someone.
You're as busy as ever, I suppose.
I am. Off to London in a while. I have a meeting this afternoon.
Well, for some.
Again, she's aware of the impatience her sister so often seems to invoke in her. Pull yourself together. Move on. She glances at her watch. Better go, actually. We'll talk again soon. They'll talk on Saturday, the 12th. Caroline will ring on Beth's birthday, like she always does. She'll be in Italy, but she won't forget to ring. And Eleanor will be morose, still wallowing in her grief after 13 years. And Caroline will want to shake her, and will hate herself for it. There's nothing you can do, Florence said. Until she wants to help herself, nothing except keep in touch, so she knows you're there if she comes looking. But so far, Eleanor hasn't come looking. Caroline leaves the bedroom and goes in search of coffee, which is generally to be found on the ground floor around this time. Sure enough, as she makes her way down the steep, narrow stairs, the aroma of newly ground beans floats up to meet her. For years, she couldn't look at coffee. Her taste for it didn't come back until she started going to Italy. She opens the kitchen door. There you are. I heard you up early. Florence misses nothing. I had things to sort for London. Caroline takes a seat at the table, where delicate cups and saucers wait. Florence loves her pretty china, even if none of it matches. Every time she breaks a piece, she replaces it with a charity shop one. As long as it says fine bone china on the bottom, she's happy. How was yesterday? She asks. Good. Caroline had spent it in Cardiff, visiting shops with her samples, pausing at lunchtime to catch up with some college friends. Not home until after Florence's 9 o'clock bedtime. I might have a new boutique. They're letting me know on Thursday. That's all very well, but you're working too hard. I keep telling you, you need a holiday. I'm getting one next week. Italy? Italy is more work. Not all the time. She hasn't told Florence about Matteo. He's her secret, for a variety of reasons. And the weather will be better, so it'll feel like a holiday, even if I'm working. Florence pours boiled water onto the grounds. You must promise me you'll relax. Have a flirt with a waiter. Caroline laughs. I might just do that. Matteo is an electrician, not a waiter, and they passed the flirting stage quite a while ago. By the way, I got an invitation to my school reunion. 20 years, can you believe it? You must go, Florence says immediately, bringing the cafetiere to the table. When is it on?
October the 10th, but
I'm marking it on the calendar. Get me a biro.
Florence, I have no intention of going.
Don't be ridiculous. Why wouldn't you go? She pulls open a drawer and rummages among the rubbish and finds a red pen.
I'm sorry I mentioned it, Caroline says, watching as her cousin draws a circle around the date.
Well, I'm not. You want some of that tea brack? I think there's a bit left.
No, thanks.
Tea brack, even one as light and spicy as Florence's, never tempted her. Why would you not want to go? Give me one good reason.
Florence, I hated that year of school. You know I did. All my friends gone, and me having to join a class where the only one I really knew was Eleanor. I felt out of place there from the first day to the last. I was counting the days till I could come back here.
But that's exactly why you should go. Look at you. Look how far you've come. You're a self-made, successful businesswoman, and you look like $1 million. You can hold your head up high and wear one of your beautiful creations, and let them see how well you turned out. Caroline watches the grounds swirling about in the cafetiere. She breathes in the dark, nutty scent of water turning itself into coffee.
They wouldn't care. They'd hardly remember me. Anyway, my mind's made up. And Eleanor isn't going either.
Oh, well, Eleanor.
Florence takes her seat, tucks her chair in.
You spoke to her?
She rang, just now.
Florence depresses the plunger and pours the coffee, her silence saying plenty.
She and Eleanor met exactly once, 13 years ago. They've spoken on the phone less than half a dozen times. Nothing has ever been said, but Caroline gets the impression that as far as Florence is concerned, that amount of interaction was quite enough.
We never had school reunions. Florence lets a single brown sugar lump fall with a plop into her cup. Nothing like that in my day. I wouldn't have minded.
I'd have quite liked to see where everyone ended up, especially the no-hopers like myself.
Don't say that.
Why not? It's true. Nobody ever thought I'd make a go of anything. I'd say they were sure I'd get lost on my way to England.
When she was almost 19, Florence Cassidy left Ireland on her own with no qualifications and took the boat across the Irish Sea, like so many others were doing at the time. It was 1953, and she didn't know a single soul in London. All she had to her name were the few pounds she'd managed to put by from the textile factory job she'd had since leaving school at 14. Her only skill was being able to operate a knitting machine. What she found, she told Caroline, was a city that was still shaking off the horrors of a world war, with rationing still a way of life, not to end until the following year. What she found were people who were too busy pulling their lives back together to worry about anyone else, least of all an Irish immigrant.
I didn't let it stop me, she said. I made my way in spite of it.
She located a hostel for girls that was run by Irish nuns, and she took what jobs she could find. Leaflet distributor, church cleaner, cinema usherette, restaurant kitchen skivvy. Hanging on to each one until the meagre wages or the deplorable conditions forced her to search for something better. And then, coming home dispirited one chilly November evening from the restaurant, her hands red and raw from the scalding water in which they spent most of their time, she saw a notice in the window of the local greengrocer. Experienced knitters needed, suit housewives, it said. And Florence, who wasn't a housewife, remembered the hours she'd spent hunched over her knitting machine each day in the textile factory, and recalled how she'd vowed to find a more uplifting way to spend her life. But so far that hadn't happened, and knitting was something she was good at. And whatever was being offered here might be altogether different from the soulless factory environment, might pay better too. She rang the number on the notice, and spoke to a woman called Sybil, who didn't seem put out by Florence's Irish accent.
Let's meet, she said, and have a chat. Come to my place.
So later that week, Florence rang the top doorbell on the wall of a tall, narrow terraced house that lay just three streets north of the hostel. She was ushered up two flights of stairs and into the minuscule bedsit that Sybil rented on the top floor. And there she learnt that she would be expected to knit hats or scarves or socks or all three, in return for no pay at all.
My brother is a missionary priest in Africa, Sybil told her, over a cup of Bovril. The people he tries to help have nothing. His stories would break your heart. I want to sell knitted goods in the local market on Saturdays. A friend has a stall there, and send him whatever money I make. But I need a few more knitters to help me. I'm too slow on my own. I can supply the wool. I get end balls of dye lots for nothing from one of my aunts who runs a wool shop, but there wouldn't be any payment. That's why I said suit housewives. I thought they might do it to pass the time while their children were at school.
Florence explained that she wasn't a housewife in search of a hobby.
I wash dishes in a restaurant, she said. I'm on my feet all day, and my boss is an ignorant man who pays me barely enough to survive on and never offers me leftovers to take home. I was hoping to find something a bit better.
But she'd taken to Sybil, plain and 30-ish and part-time social worker, whose narrow single bed had a tatty pink dressing gown in place of an eiderdown, whose floor beneath the window was piled high with dog-eared paperbacks, whose pale blue eyes were as innocent as a child's, whose guileless smile took over her face.
I'll knit for you in my spare time, Florence said. And I'll ask the other girls in the hostel if they'll help.
She told Sybil about her experience in the textile factory.
I could hand knit, but a machine would be a lot quicker. Could your aunt find us a second-hand one? Or would she know someone who'd loan us one, and I could teach you how to use it too?
And a friendship was begun that lasted till Sybil's death in a plane crash almost 20 years later, on her way to Africa to visit her brother, a trip that had been long in the planning. After her death, Florence packed up and moved out of London, taking with her the knitting machine she and Sybil had bought between them on the Never Never, the savings she'd managed to scrape together over the years,
and the few pounds left to her by Sybil. She settled in a town 80 miles north of the capital and found herself a job in a garden centre and a bedsit to rent above a chemist that was twice as big as, and half the price of, the tiny basement flat she and Sybil had ended up sharing in London. 10 months later, she walked into the bank and came out with a modest mortgage on a small rundown cottage whose 300-year-old walls were still rock solid. In the meantime, she discovered another market in which to sell the hats and scarves and socks she still churned out in her spare time, the proceeds of which she continued to send to Sybil's brother, and after his death, to the community of priests that survived him, until she'd finally given up the market stall a few years ago, when the standing and the weather became too much for her arthritic hips. And when Caroline Plunkett was 17, Florence saved her life. Caroline came to her, broken and despairing, and Florence, who was almost 60 by then, opened her door and took her in, and never once allowed Caroline to feel sorry for herself. "What happened, happened," she said. "You're not the first and you won't be the last. Deal with it." And because she backed up her blunt words with endless patience and countless acts of kindness, Caroline learned how to put the past behind her and move on. And over the course of the year they spent together, she fell thoroughly in love with Florence. At the end of the year, she went home to Ireland and completed her final year of secondary school. She moved to Wales the following autumn to take up the college place she'd secured there, much to her mother's disapproval, and graduated 4 years later with a degree in fashion design. Immediately afterwards, she returned again to Ireland, staying only long enough to move out of the house she and Eleanor had grown up in. She stripped her bed and vacuumed her room and took her posters from the walls. She boxed up her books and packed two suitcases and put what was left over into a bag for the charity shop. And 6 years after their first encounter, Caroline flew back across the Irish Sea to be reunited with Florence. And since then, she's lived in the collection of tiny slant-ceilinged rooms that are tucked beneath the roof of her cousin's little cottage. And Florence potters about below her in the ground floor rooms. The arrangement suits both of them perfectly. Florence, whose precise relationship to Caroline has never been properly worked out, some class of a cousin, two or three times removed, will be 81 at the beginning of October. The number means precisely nothing to her. "You're as old as you decide to be," she says. "I've been 40 for the past 40 years." For as long as Caroline has known her, Florence has danced to her own melody. Never married, frequently broke, unflinchingly honest. She's the bravest person Caroline has ever met.
"What are you doing with yourself today?"
"I'm going shopping."
Florence's shopping takes the whole afternoon. She does the rounds of the town's charity shops and tries on an impressive proportion of its offerings and spends a maximum of £10 in total. Her wardrobe is never the same from 1 week to the next. For every sweater she brings home, she donates one or two she bought the month before, or a handbag she's used twice, or trousers she's sick of.
"I'm doing steaks tonight," Caroline says. "Don't be late."
Every Tuesday, Florence climbs the stairs for dinner. The rest of the week they dine separately, apart from Sunday when they go out for lunch, Caroline's treat, to the Hound and Hare a quarter of a mile away. Florence has a glass of beer beforehand and an Irish coffee afterwards and never touches alcohol otherwise, apart from the mulled wine she takes each New Year's Eve. And every morning that Caroline is at home, they drink excellent Italian coffee in Florence's kitchen. They sit and talk as a watery September sun splashes onto the cracked terracotta tiles that Florence refuses to allow Caroline to replace. They talk about Angie in the library, whose daughter was caught shoplifting in Boots in Oxford, and about Phil the postwoman, who found a canvas shopping bag full of live kittens by the riverbank, and about Caroline's plan to introduce a new line of baby wear to her range. And as Caroline is getting to her feet, Florence urges her again to attend the school reunion,
and Caroline assures her again that she has no intention of it. I'm going to keep on at you, Florence warns, until you change your mind.
Good luck with that.
Once she fixes on a thing, Florence's tenacity is truly impressive. But Caroline can be every bit as stubborn. Nearly forgot, Florence says, pulling an envelope from behind the stacked saucepans on the worktop. This came for you yesterday. Handwriting she doesn't recognize. Brighton postmark, no return address. The only people she knows in Brighton are those who work in the boutique she sells into.
See you later. Have a good day.
She studies the envelope as she climbs the stairs. A new inquiry, maybe. She gets the occasional letter, although most people email or phone now. In her room, she takes the reunion invitation from the waste paper basket and studies it for several seconds before tearing it into pieces that float back down like snowflakes. Despite what Florence says, she has nothing she wants to prove. Let them reunite without her. She slides a finger under the flap of the other envelope. She pulls out the single page and unfolds it and begins to read. Her hand flies to her mouth. She sinks onto a chair. Her eyes fill. The words swim together. Part 1. June 1993. Eleanor. She tapped on the door. Come in! How well she knew that voice, how often it had invited her in. She turned the handle and entered the room. Ah, Eleanor. It was sighed out by Sister Carmody, who wasn't seated behind her big wooden desk, but standing with her back to one of the windows that began at the level of her shoulders and climbed upwards. Please close the door and have a seat. She herself remained standing, arms disappearing behind her, hands presumably clasped above her substantial grey tweed backside. I've had a phone call, she said, in the same mournful tone. Pause. Eleanor waited, her eyes fixed on the black pen that extended on a tilt from its brass holder on the desk. She wondered who'd been on the phone and what they'd caught her doing. She imagined grabbing the pen and driving it into Sister Carmody's pink cardiganed chest. Would you care to hear what it was about, Eleanor? The barest suggestion of impatience, just that. Sister Carmody never lost her temper at school. She must have a punching bag in her bedroom that got the brunt every night. Take that, Eleanor Plunkett, and that! Eleanor shifted in her seat and made a non-committal sound. What was needed here was some show of repentance, some evidence of shame. She ducked her head and looked at her shoes. That might do it. On Saturday night, Eleanor, you were seen coming out of a public house on Dominic Street, in the company of several males. It would appear, another pause, that you were not completely sober. Not completely sober, no. She and Andrew had gone to McMurray's with Tony, whose 18th birthday it was, and a few of the others. They'd sat at a corner table, and she'd laced her glasses of orange juice with gin she'd swiped from the sitting room cabinet. By 11 o'clock she was giddy and giggling, and trying to recite Hamlet's soliloquy. Yes, she'd definitely have looked a bit unsteady coming out, hanging on to Andrew as they made their way to Enzio's for chips. She wondered who'd squealed on her. I don't think I need to remind you, Eleanor, that your exams begin in 3 days.
No, you need not.
She was hardly likely to forget about the junior cert. Everyone getting summer holidays tomorrow, apart from the third and sixth years who were facing into 2 weeks of exams. But she'd get by. She always managed to get by. Let Caroline slog all she wanted for her A grades. Eleanor had no use or desire for them. Her left shoe was marked on the toe, a grey smudge on the brown leather. It might come off with a swipe of a damp cloth. She hated when her shoes weren't clean. Your parents would be so disappointed, Eleanor. Here it came, the guilt trip. Her parents would almost certainly have heard her coming in last night. She'd practically fallen up the stairs. But as long as she was out with Andrew Darcy, whose father could buy and sell the Plunketts several times over, she got away with it. Now, I've decided not to involve them on this occasion, provided I have your solemn promise that it won't happen again.
Eleanor looked up.
I promise, sister. I promise I won't get caught next time. I promise I'll wear a hoodie next time.
She wondered if Andrew had given up waiting for her. She could murder a can of Coke.
Sister Carmody gave a final sigh and turned away to face the window.
You may go, Eleanor.
She lifted her rucksack and got to her feet and left the office, closing the door silently. No need to give the old bat anything else to moan about. She scooted down the deserted corridor and out the front door, and there he was, sitting on the wall by the gate. He hopped down as she approached.
Thought you'd be gone, she said.
What kept you? She handed him her rucksack.
I was called into the office. Someone saw us coming out of McMurra's on Saturday and phoned the school.
Who?
No idea. Come on, I need Coke.
What did she say? Is she going to tell your parents?
No, I got off with a warning. You're so lucky to be finished with all this.
In September, he was moving to Dublin to begin his teacher training course. No question of him not getting enough points in the leaving. He was a Darcy. Naturally, he was clever enough to get loads of points without killing himself. That family was charmed. Being separated from him by 60 miles would take some getting used to, though. They'd lived a few minutes apart all their lives. They'd seen one another several times a week. On the plus side, his moving to Dublin would mean more freedom for them. Coming up to 3 years together, their first date a week after her 13th birthday. They'd gone to see Back to the Future 3. Her stomach knotted with anxiety at the thought of being on her own with Andrew Darcy. Half an hour in, he'd put his arm across the back of her seat. Their first kiss, her first ever kiss, had happened a few minutes after that. She'd taken no pleasure in it, too anxious in case she wasn't doing it right. She'd had plenty of practice since then. Lots of other stuff since then too, lots of fooling around. A few times they'd come close to going all the way. She was dying to do it, eager to see what all the fuss was about. But she wanted their first time to be right, not some rushed, uncomfortable fumble somewhere. So she was holding out for Dublin and whatever bed he ended up renting. She had it all planned. She'd hop on the bus every second Saturday. Nobody could object as long as she came home that night. The first bus got to Dublin at 10. They could spend the whole day in bed. The thought sent a delicious hot swoosh through her. She'd thought of everything, from the omelets she'd make for their lunch, wearing only his shirt, to the bag of Bewley's coffee he was going to have ready for her to take home. Of course, they'd have to use protection. She had no intention of getting caught out. She knew, everyone did, about the dangerous days that she could simply avoid, as long as she kept an eye on her temperature. But that wouldn't work if they were limited to once a fortnight. Andrew would have to get condoms. He could sort that out. His father probably had a stash. The old goat had to be doing it with half the women in town. Do it with her if she gave him half a chance, leering at her chest any time she wore something that showed it off a bit. The only downside to marrying Andrew was getting Jasper for a father-in-law. Still, she'd think of the money they'd inherit one day and put up with him. Neither she nor Andrew had mentioned marriage yet, but it was there in their future, waiting for them. It was like a natural law that they'd end up together, that she'd change her name to Eleanor Darcy. She loved the sound of it, like a character straight out of Jane Austen. She almost felt guilty sometimes that finding her soulmate had been so simple. She and Andrew had sort of gravitated together. Around the time that she was beginning to have feelings for him, he'd asked if she'd like to go to the cinema. And just like that, they'd become a couple. And one day, they'd be man and wife. She'd wear red, or maybe burgundy. White did nothing for her. Caroline would be her bridesmaid, of course. She could hardly pass her over in favor of one of her friends. She didn't imagine her sister would ever get married. 17 a month ago and never out on a date, not a single one. Caroline wasn't interested in boys. She was too busy studying for her leaving cert, which was still a year away. She was good at everything in school, even art.
Little wonder their teachers found it hard to believe that she and Eleanor were sisters. They didn't look remotely alike either. Eleanor was prettier. No one could deny that. Eyes, hair, figure, everything was better. But if Caroline made an effort, wore some makeup, did something with her hair, ditched the boring long skirts and started wearing normal clothes, she mightn't be bad. Eleanor could try fixing her up with one of Andrew's friends. Not Tony, he was daft, and Josh wouldn't be interested, he only had eyes for blondes. Maybe Patrick. He wasn't exactly an intellectual, but opposites might attract, and at least he was as tall as her. What about Patrick and Caroline? She asked. Andrew kicked a pebble on the path, sent it bouncing ahead of them. What about them? Would he go for her? He hitched her rucksack higher on his shoulder. Would he go for her? He aimed at another pebble, missed it. Was he being deliberately obtuse? I think we should get them together, she said. Why? She'll never get a boyfriend unless we help her out. He gave her a funny look. What makes you think she'll never get a boyfriend? Oh, come on, look at her. She's older than me and she's never been on a date. She will, he said, when she's ready. There's nothing wrong with taking your time. Leave her alone. He sounded almost cross. She wondered what was eating him. They reached the shop and he went in without a word and emerged with two cans of Coke. He handed her one and flicked open the other and drank without stopping until it was empty. He crushed it and flung it away, and she watched it clattering onto the road. Not like him to litter the place.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.